Welcome to your program, Jeremiah 2911. And today I am so excited. I am so blessed. I'm so happy. We have special guests. We have Pastor and Dr. Martin Telezing and his wonderful wife, Emma. And we love them so much because they're pastors, but they're also our co-laborers in Christ. Amen. And our friends, and we just love them so much. And I'm so blessed to have them in our lives as our friends, Amen. You know? And it's so amazing, so welcome, and thank you for coming.
Thank you. Pray to God.
Amen.
Amen.
And the name of the program today is called Beyond the Gate of Hell. It's an intense program. It is a program, if you have somebody that you know that doesn't know Lord Jesus, the Lord Jesus, have them tune in. Amen. Amen. Because this program will change their lives. Amen.
Amen.
And Dr. Telezing, Brother Martin, wrote a book called Beyond the Gate of Hell. And this is what the program is about today. About his spiritual experience that the Lord took him in December of 2000 when he was at his home in Los Angeles. He had an spiritual experience where he went beyond the gates of hell. Wow. And you know, what I like about this book is that it points people to the fact that you have to make a choice. Yep. You know, you either have to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior or not. The Word of God says that the wages of sin are death. So we all have to make a choice whether to serve God or not serve Him. It's up to you. God gives us a sovereign will. But we have to understand that there's a consequence for our choices. If we choose to accept the Lord, we're going to go to heaven. If we do not choose the Lord, we're going to go to hell. And I don't mean to be a doom and gloom preacher, but it's the truth. And I'm telling you this because I love you. Amen?
Amen.
The Word of God said, God so loved the world that He gave His begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him shall not perish but have eternal life.
Amen.
It's your choice. And it's our responsibility as preachers of the gospel to tell you that there is a hell and that it is real. And if you do not repent from your sins, that's where you're going to end up. And it's not what I say, it's what the Word of God says. Amen?
Amen.
And before we start the program, I am going to ask Sister Emma to pray for the program because she's an anointed woman of God.
Amen.
And one of the things that I love about her, which was a witness to me, Dexter and Brother Martin,
Amen.
Was in, we've been to their church, and in their church service, they have a part where they talk about repentance, and they look inside to see what doesn't please the Lord. And when I was there the last time, I saw her heart of repentance, how she wanted to be clean before God, and how she was just pushing in. And I said, Lord, I need to push in like she does and search myself. So you are a blessing to me.
Amen.
So can you please start the program with prayer? Amen.
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 Thank you, Father, for today. Thank you for this opportunity that we came here to this TV program with my sisters and brother. We are so pleased to be here. We want to call upon your blessing on this program. Whatever we are going to talk about, it will be only your word and it will be only the truth. We want you to bless our brother Martin, that he is here to give his word, your word, with his experience that he had in hell. Thank you for this opportunity again, and want you to anoint us and the listeners that they are listening in this moment, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ. And whatever we talk about, to touch each one of them that they are watching right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
And Dexter,
Amen.
How does it feel to be with Amen. An someone from Cameroon, Africa, with an Armenian and a Venezuelan Jew. How do you feel? With the nations and the table.
Amen. Well, this is the gospel. And this is actually Ephesians, which I love, which is the wall of separation between all cultures is gone in Christ. And this is one of my favorite things about being in the body of Christ, is that we get to love and have fellowship in every different culture. Amen. And that's just such a joy to me. And so welcome, Pastor Martin.
Amen.
And Pastor Emma, we're just so blessed to have you here today. And today, again, brothers and sisters, we're going to talk about beyond the gate of hell. Amen. And before I get to that, I'm going to read two scriptures, because a lot of people don't want to talk about hell. But you know what? It can save your soul. It can save the soul of your family members. And it can actually put you, and the Holy Spirit just fell on me, Amen. On fire to pray Acts 16:31 over your whole family. Amen. So not one of them will go to the eternal torments of hell. Amen. And I am telling you, the gulf between heaven and hell is so wide. Eternal fellowship and love of our Father, Abba Father, and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, and all our brothers and sisters, Amen. Worshiping and praising each the Lord God Almighty, being in His eternal loving presence, having those waves of love come over us in heaven when we choose Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, or hell, which is eternal torment where there is no rest, no sleep, no break from that eternal torment. And that's why today, and I just pray that many of you will have a fire for salvation for those that are not saved, in your family and beyond your family, your friends, your co-workers. And so you'll start praying Acts 16:31 as you believe you and your whole house will be saved, and start praying for the salvation of everyone around you. And not only that, I pray today that the fear of God comes over you, so that you work out your salvation, as the word says, with fear and trembling all the days of your life. And you understand that there is always a gateway to salvation. There's a gateway to be cleansed, that is the blood of the Lamb of God, when you repent before the Lord. And to know that and to follow Him, precious Jesus, for eternal salvation, there's nothing more important in your life. So with that, I'm just going to read a couple of scriptures, and we're going to talk about the book.
Amen.
And one is Matthew 18 verses 8 and 9. This is the word of the Lord that Jesus Christ is teaching about how important it is that we repent of our sins and come to the saving knowledge of faith in Jesus Christ. Not only that we repent, but we're freed of those sins, which is what Romans 6 through 8 teaches us. He says, if your hand or foot causes you to sin, cut it off and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life lame or maimed, that he's talking about eternal life, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into the everlasting fire. And if your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out and cast it from you. It is better for you to enter into life with one eye, rather than having two eyes to be cast into hell fire. Amen. So this is not imaginary hell, and we're going to hear about this testimony. And I want to read one more, which really Jesus again is speaking. These are letters in red, and it's Luke 12, verses 4 and 5. He says, and I say to you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body. In other words, don't be afraid of death on this earth. That's just a pathway to eternal life with Jesus in heaven. He says, and after that, they have no more that they can do to you. They can't, because you'll be, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you'll be in heaven. They can't touch you anymore. But I will show you whom you should fear. Fear Him, capital H, talking about Jesus and the Father, who after He has killed, has power to cast into hell. Yes, I say to you, fear Him.
Yes, Lord.
Our fear, yeah, we are. Remember, the Word of God says, fear is the beginning of understanding. And I believe in my own life, fear before a holy God of my sins is what led me to true godly sorrow and repentance. Because I saw my sins before a holy God, as in Isaiah 6. And it terrified me that I was sinning against a holy God. So, Pastor Martin, this book was written because of a supernatural experience that you had.
Yes, yes.
And glory be to God for that, because Amen. This will be a witness that I believe will touch many of our brothers and sisters. Amen. So in December of 2000, yes. Tell us what happened to you, what led you into this, Amen. What was going on in your life?
Well, before I start, I just want to first thank God for us being here Amen. And to share the good news of the kingdom. Because hell is not our destination, but it is used an element of warning to those who haven't made a decision
Amen.
To follow Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.
And it is a great time for us to understand that time is short. Like we say, Jesus is coming back soon.
Amen.
And we need to be ready.
Amen.
And our job is not only to be ready for ourselves, but to make the nations and the souls ready for the coming of Christ.
Amen.
Yes. My personal life, I'm a university professor. So on this very day of December 4, 2000, I just got up as every morning and was getting ready to go to university to teach, as I do every morning. Mm-hmm. So there was nothing in my mind that could prepare me for this particular experience. So as I went to my study room, because in my house I had made a room for my study, meditation, prayer, etc., and reading of my Bible and all the other books that are connecting me to Jesus Christ. As I was in the room that morning, I felt suddenly very weak.
Wow.
Weak, so weak that I couldn't stand up. So it was winter morning, as we know, in December. And I just decided, I said, well, maybe I should do something to break this, because I didn't want to go back to sleep. So, but since the power was so strong, I found myself, I decided to just lay down in the little bed that I had made in my office for a little nap sometime, and I lay down there. Once I lay down, I realized that I couldn't move. I was wide awake in my mind and spiritual, but I couldn't move any part of my body. And then I began to sense the presence of someone in the room. Somebody I did not see, but I just knew there was someone in the room.
Amen.
And this when I started thinking, well, what is happening here? I'm not asleep. But I know there's somebody in the room. Then in the spirit, I found myself standing up in the room. And this angelic being was standing on this side of me towards the back. And I turned to see him, but he turned with me so I couldn't see him. And I was worried because I didn't know what was going on. So he said, I am a messenger of the Lord sent to take you to a trip to hell. Now that's something you don't want to hear in the morning when you're getting ready to go to work. You don't want to hear such a thing.
Exactly.
Oh my goodness. And
especially if you haven't repented, you don't know. So
yeah.
In my mind, I'm thinking, oh my God, this is the last day. my life. I didn't want to go, of course. I started, so many thoughts begin to creep in my mind.
Oh, yeah.
I said, what did I do that I have to go to hell now? And my wife was in the other room, still sleeping. And I said, God, I don't even have a chance to say bye to them. You know, when that happens.
Wow.
And as he spoke, there was nothing I can say. Before we know, we left like a twinkle of an eye.
Yeah.
Wow.
We stood, we walked through a path that looked like a paved road toward this gate. And a copy of a photo of that gate is in my book. Something similar.
Yeah.
It was tall, in the middle of nowhere, no wall sustaining it, and we just came there, but it was closed. And I said, oh my God, this is the gate of hell. And he told me that his role was to protect me, to guide me, but then I had to do whatever he said. I have to obey him.
Wow.
So a lot of details are in the book.
Yeah.
And that's what happened that morning. I found myself by the gate of hell. And when I looked around me, I said, but this cannot be the gate of hell, because it didn't, I didn't see any, you know, our belief system says we're going to see a lot of fire and all this. That's what I was expecting. But it wasn't like that. So, of course, I was not yet in hell. I was still outside of hell. So I looked around. It was beautiful. When I say beautiful, meaning that the outside of hell, which was a spiritual dimension, spiritual world, didn't look anything like what was inside the hell. I looked it up. There was like this type of sky with no star, no moon, no nothing. It was just blank. And then all around, well, where I stood, there was like this, the floor was like some kind of a tapestry, like grayish, it was grayish, and it went rolling almost infinite inside. And I was looking for, see if there was plant or water, and there was none of those. No.
Almost
water.
Like rolling hills of gray.
Yes, of gray.
Wow. Uh-huh.
No tree, just like that. Just a few patches of grass, like the echinacea, you know, the echinacea grass. That's what I saw, something like that. But then there was this light that was hovering in the area. You couldn't trace the source of the light on the outside of the gate. It was so interesting. And then there were people waiting for the gate to open so that they could go in. So our concept of hell, which we know to be true biblically, is that people would be thrown in hell. But the angel told me that this was only one of the multitudes of gates of hell.
Yeah.
And he said that there were so many, the many other gates. This was the one that the one where I was standing was made to look deceiving for the soul going to hell. So they would not know they were going to hell until they passed through the gate. So I was given the opportunity to talk to some of the souls that were that was around waiting to be to enter into hell. So the two cases that I want to mention, because they really were very intriguing. First of all, there was a young man in his early 20s, and I approached him. I asked him why he was there. He said he had killed some people on earth, and he was sentenced to death, to die, but he didn't feel guilty because he had a reason.
Yeah, to kill them. They deserved it.
Yeah, they deserved to die.
Yeah.
For him, he was justified in his action.
Wow.
So he was electrocuted. I knew that he was still on an electric chair because there was still some scars of electric burn on him.
Wow.
So when he talked to me like that, he really didn't feel like he did anything wrong. And nobody by that gate had any idea that beyond the gate was hell. But they look at themselves, they were good, healthy, there was no deformity, physical deformity, and they were just, they looked like the soul body was somehow perfect. Mm-hmm. We could use the word perfect in that sense that they were healthy, they were young, like teenage, all the way to mid-adult. Mm-hmm. Nobody, no old person, but they looked like that.
Mm-hmm.
The other young man that I approached also and talked to, he had been a very stubborn young man in his life. Ruffian, living life to the fullest, and he died by accident. And whenever I talked to them, they didn't seem to really care about the people they left behind. They were so happy and looking forward to cross over, pass through this gate, to what we call here rest in peace. You know, when somebody dies, you always say R.I.P.
Yeah.
So rest in peace.
Wow.
But I was not allowed to tell them that where they were standing was by the gate of hell. So I began to feel like the picture didn't fit what I have learned, especially from my former religion, a denomination, that taught us that, you know, when you die, if you go into hell, they just throw you in there. So the angel told me that there are other gates of hell for people that have sold their soul to Satan through covenant, through pacting, through practicing witchcrafts and magic, sorcery. Those who have sold their soul to Satan, they say when they are about to die, the gate of hell comes on location to swallow them.
They're just swallowed in.
Yes.
Yeah.
So they don't have to wait like these people here.
Right.
They just swallow them. And they said even at the time, they feel horrible. So then that allowed me to understand that hell was not one huge city where everybody goes to the same place.
Right.
And then this gate was tall, like a French gate, very tall, with two doors. And the doors were like bronze or something like that, bronze color. And there were some indentation, you know, like indentation going in. And the angel told me that each one of those indentation, there were five of them, each one of those indentation was the gate into a level of hell. He said, where I stood were five levels beneath. So each one, when the soul would go to hell, one of these indentation was be the gateway into their level of hell where they would go. And they were walking around, waiting for the gate to open and speaking to each other very peacefully, speaking different languages. And I did not understand what they were saying because I wasn't allowed to understand what they were saying to each other.
So in general, were they kind of anxious to get in to the door? Did they want to go through the door?
Yes.
Yeah, because they didn't know what was beyond.
They didn't know what was beyond.
Yeah.
So the angels explained to me that, you know, they made that to look like that for these souls to know, to not to know what's awaiting them on the other side until the crossover. Wow. That's when they would know where they're gone.
Yeah. So they were probably happy to be at the door and waiting for it to open.
They were very rejoicing. They were rejoicing. Actually, I approached another young man because most of the people that I talked there were young fellows.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted to know if he remembered where he came from. The majority, they knew where they came from. They knew. They all told me, yeah, we know we've died from Earth. We've died on Earth. Mm-hmm. But look at our body. We look okay now. We're fine.
Yeah.
You know, we have no problems. And so he said, no, why would I... I said, if you have a message for me to take back. He looked at me weird because he didn't understand why a person would leave that place to go back to this world. And so I said, yeah, I tried to explain to him that I wasn't dead, that I was brought there as an investigator to know what was going on and go back to the world of the living to tell them the story.
Mm-hmm.
But he didn't care. He said, he didn't believe me at all. And he just walked away. And there was this other guy. He was very intelligent. Very intelligent. And I could speak with him logically. Oh, by the way, let me explain something here. In the spiritual world, we don't speak a specific language. It's like words are understood, expressed. You just know what the other person is saying, and you answer that person.
Mm.
You're not speaking in English, you're not speaking in African or French, you're just speaking the spiritual language.
Wow.
Everybody seems to understand everybody, no matter what expression you use, everything's clear.
Mm-hmm.
So, anyway, as we waited there, I'm really bringing a long story short because of the time, but everything is written in the book here.
Yeah.
As I'm waiting there, I see a few other souls begin to bully others because they didn't remember that these other ones did not remember that they had died. They thought they were still alive because they saw themselves in their body, so they started to bully other souls there. And one even came, tried to bully me. I just walked away. In the meantime, the angels is behind me, following everything and making suggestions whenever possible. Now, at a certain point, everybody started to be drawn toward the gate and gather there in a crowd. And I was looking to see who called them. There was no voice. There was no message. It's just like a force, an invisible force, just grouped them together. And nobody could resist that force. And when they were all gathered together, I was made aware that the gate was about to open.
Wow.
And then as we waited for the gate to open, there was suddenly the crowd just parted to leave some passage where other souls coming from Earth were going to pass through to join the crowd. By the way, the gate was facing east because we came from the Earth from the east towards the gate, so the gate was facing east. So these souls were coming from the Earth, and they were coming from the east. They were walking in on a two by two, on a long line that disappeared in the horizon. And there was in this pathway, the same pathway that we used to come to the gate of hell. And they were coming, they were rejoicing somewhere, even singing somewhere, praising, and they came. So the angel said, okay, now go talk to them. And this particular crowd, there was a lot of ladies. A lot of ladies. The other one with a lot of men, this one with a lot of ladies. So I went there, and I spoke to some of the ladies that were in that line. One of them told me that, and she was speaking for many of them, she said, hey, I was a Christian. I went to church, and my church said, after death, there's nothing. We'll go to sleep, and we wait for the resurrection day.
Mm-hmm.
I'm surprised that I'm alive.
Wow.
Now, and then the other one said, well, you know what? We had a great time. We went to church. We live our life fully. We slept around with men to prove ourselves. Anyway, after death, it's only heaven.
Wow.
So they were taught that once you die, wow, you're going straight to heaven because you went to church.
Wow.
So they thought they were going to heaven.
They were going to heaven.
Wow.
That's why they were rejoicing in this condition.
Yeah, that's why the line is and they're like, wow, this is nice. They see this nice landscape, rolling hills.
Yes.
They don't see fire torment. No. And from everything I heard, this looks pretty good.
Exactly.
And an afterlife, and the whole point being, they're not dead permanently either.
No.
They have an afterlife, and they're just thinking this is going to be good.
Exactly.
Wow.
Made okay.
We made it. Yep. Yeah.
And the other one was say that for them, there's absolutely no life after you die. After you die, you become nothing.
Yeah.
And she was surprised to see that after she died, she did not become nothing.
Yeah.
She was still something. So every one of them gave me their version mm-hmm. of Christianity. And the funny part in this particular crowd, there were lots of Christians, lots of churchgoers, lots of, I would call, believers.
Wow.
That's why the Bible is very clear when Jesus said, you say you believe. But Satan believed too, and he trembles.
Yeah.
So that became so clear for me in that day.
Ooh.
And they also joined the crowd. And the angel taught me something that I would never forget. Because I asked them, why? Why are all these people here? He said, they're all here, all of them, for one single reason. They died without repentance.
Without repentance.
Wow. That was the reason.
Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is
yes.
at hand.
There was not. It wasn't about the life they live as much as the fact that they did not repent of their sins. Now, how can you repent of your sin if you know that, if you say that after death you're going to go to sleep, or if you say that after death there's nothing, or if you say that after death you're just going to go to heaven no matter what? So this is the confusions. These are the confusions that lead a lot of our, you know, Christians astray sometimes.
Yeah.
And
there's the deceptions of the devil.
Yes.
The deceptions of the devil to get people to feel secure.
Yes.
Because they don't know the word of God.
Yes.
That's why you have to guard your salvation with trembling.
Amen.
Because the enemy is looking who he's going to devour.
Amen.
Don't let people tell you what the gospel is. Find out. Read it yourself.
Read it yourself. That's right.
Amen.
Don't let someone tickle your ears. I mean, because Pastor Martin, it says that. Jesus says, depart from me, you practicers of iniquity, for I never knew you.
Yes.
But before that it says, but I preached in your name.
Yes.
I cast out demons in your name. I prophesied in your name. But the word that he says at the end is, depart from me, you practicers of iniquity. I never knew you.
Amen.
Which means two things. They didn't had no personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and they continued practicing their iniquity. Amen. Because they were taught you didn't need to repent anymore.
Exactly.
You which know, is not the word of God.
Dexter, before we started the program, I was looking at the gate of hell, and when I saw it, my reaction was, I do not want to go there. I need to repent, have a lifestyle of repentance, of holiness, because I do not want to end up there.
Amen.
And you know, the only thing that guarantees you don't go there is Jesus, and for you to examine yourself on a daily basis and repent. Amen.
Amen.
Wow. So what else happened?
Amen.
I'm excited. I'm on the edge of my seat.
Before I continue, I want to tell you, you that are sitting and watching, keep an open mind. We bind every spirit of doubt.
Yes,
that's right.
Jesus.
We bind every spirit of that doesn't believe.
Yes.
Because the doubt that is going to be put in your heart,
yes,
because you think this is not real, is that doubt that's going to give you the weakness that Satan needs to invade you and prevent you to go to heaven.
Yes.
Please rebuke that spirit of doubt out of you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 So, as we suddenly, and I'm cutting the story because there's so
the
many
door stories. Opened.
The door opened.
Wow.
Boom. And when the door opened, two gatekeepers appeared.
Yeah. There's always an order.
Yes. Two gatekeepers, they appeared at the gate, and they were dressed in a uniform, same outfit. And that again threw a doubt in me, because I thought, when the gate opens, I'm going to see devils, black hood, broken wings, and all that. No. These two gatekeepers looked human.
Yeah.
And they were dressed also in gray and black. Now they came to the door, and they had a book. It was this book.
Yeah.
And that was a book of, I would call it a book of death, but I call it a book of records. In that book, when they opened the book, they call each soul by their last name. Oh, brothers and sisters, you don't want to stand there and hear a dark entity call you by name.
Amen.
You don't want that.
Yes.
And when they call each person by name, last name only, there was a number attached to that name, like a census number. And when they call your name, everything that you've done that condemns you just appeared right away. And they all knew, all these two gatekeepers knew, whatever you've done that led you there. Mm. Once you responded to your name, you took one step, you disappeared. And the whole process lasted also like a twinkling of an eye. Pop up. all those millions of people that were waiting there disappear.
All through the gate.
Millions of people?
Yeah.
All through the gate.
Huge crowd. It just went through the gate like nothing. Now, I was back, just found myself there alone, and I went to the gate because I thought I have authority over them. I said, but you need to let me in. And I'm supposed to go in there. They look at me, they say, no, you don't belong here. I said, why?
Hallelujah.
You don't belong here. I said, why? And they said, because.
I would have turned around and said, I'm going back to my bed.
Yeah. But I said, why? They said, because your name is not in this book.
Amen.
I said, but I have to go there. I have a mission in there. And they look at me like, you have no order to give us. Mm. You understand that? But at the same time, they saw my guardian, my guiding angel.
Yeah.
Because this angel was not my guardian angel. He was my guiding angel.
Mm-hmm.
He was guiding me. They saw him. And then they say something that kind of gave me some courage. Because up to that point, I was still afraid that if I went in there, I may never come back out.
Yeah.
So she will find me dead in the morning. And she will be praising God, he's in heaven, when I'm really down there. You understand? I got afraid. But when they told me that, oh, you are one of those that come from the world of the living to visit this place of doom and to go back and tell the living about it.
Wow.
I said, oh, so some people have come before me and they have gone back. Thank God.
Wow.
I felt emboldened.
Yeah.
I felt emboldened. So, but as they were speaking, I was talking with one of them, I saw a number appear from nowhere. That number was written, I think, in Roman character, with probably nine digits, something like that. And he said, oh, okay. So he did not write my name in the book. He took a separate document and wrote my name on it. I said, now you can go in.
Wow.
When you say that, puff, I was inside.
Wow.
I was in the first part of the first hell. First part of the first hell. Remember this. Because hell is divided into levels, and at each level, there are parts based on the punishment of the soul in proportion with the degree of their sinfulness.
Yeah. So the levels of torment will increase as the levels go down.
Go down.
And you're in the least of the levels for the least torment.
The angels say where you are, it's where there is the least possible torment. Because you cannot stand any torment higher than this. So, I was excited until I looked back at the gate. It was shut, and the gatekeeper had vanished. So no way out. And I'm standing there, and I look at these souls. They were like, people carrying such a heavy burden. They were not walking straight anymore. They didn't look healthy like they looked outside anymore. Wow. Now they have changed. They were now being tormenting soul, looking ugly. And they were walking very heavily on the weight of the pain. But to me, I said, well, where? I looked at, for first thing I wanted to see was the fire and the demons. Because I was confident that I had my protection.
Yeah.
Yes or no? But where I was, there was no fire. There was no humanoid demon, meaning a demon looking like us. But on the floor, when I looked down on the floor, first of all, the angel put me in a circular spot that he called the safe spot, meaning I was safe only in that particular spot. All around me on the ground was infested by these goldenrod rats and mouses, and they were running towards the souls, and they were speaking, they were communicating with each other in a language that I personally did not understand, but they were communicating. Mm-hmm. And then they would separate into either groups of two and or groups of more than two, and they would go and attack the souls. Ooh. They would invade the soul, and the soul would fall on their back. And then they would start to chew the soul from the sore of the feet and just eat their way through the soul body of the person all the way to the head. And as they chew their way inside, the soul will feel every bite of it. And they will scream their voice out. And they will bloat. I don't know, it's, you have this thing called Michelin. You know the Michelin that you, it's made with tires.
Yeah, Michelin
they
tire
man. They bloat and look like that.
Yeah.
Whoa.
And after a while, and there would be like a pus inside. They eat, it would look like pus coming out. And then they would leave just the time for the soul to breathe. And then they will come back and repeat the same process over
and over
and over
for all
eternity.
Eternity. Unless they would go to another level.
Yes.
Or
we would, yeah, there was a, some of them would go down to the second level.
Yeah.
But when you go down to the second level or to the second part of the first hell, suffering doesn't decrease.
It increases. Right. Wow.
And as I was there, I felt chill. Just watching these souls, I say, how can a human being kind of stand this for eternity? Wow. And I want to say this to our audience. God is love, but He's also a God of justice.
Yeah.
What He has decreed never changes. He has set the universe in motion. Trillions of years ago, the universe is still obeying Him. Mm-hmm. But through His love, He created you and me.
Yeah.
And to live image. With Him in glory.
That's right.
Not to go to a place of doom.
Amen.
And darkness and pain and suffering.
Amen.
And He's only wants some very simple thing, to repent. Brothers and sisters, whoever you are, if you have not repented of your sin, no good deed would take you to heaven. Mm. You can give billions of dollars to the church. Mm. You can build billions of cathedrals. Mm. That word repentance is the reason why these souls were where they are. It wasn't about fame, good deeds. It was about being broken in Christ and let the blood of Jesus cleanse us.
Amen.
You know, and I just want to read that, but it's Acts 2:38, brothers and sisters. You know, this is the word of God. The first act of evangelism was on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit fell on the original disciples. And then 3,000 got saved. And listen to what happens when they were, the word says that they were cut to the heart and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Men and brethren, what shall we do?" Then Peter said to them, and this just confirms the word, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promises to you and to your children, and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call."
Amen.
This is the word of the Lord, and it always starts with repentance, and you put your faith and trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross. And you're baptized into Him, and your old nature dies, and you're reborn into Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit comes on you, and hallelujah, empowers you to serve Him and love Him in the power of the resurrection, including having victory over every area that sin had dominion over you. It is now broken by the power of the cross.
Amen. Dexter, I want to use a definition that my pastor's wife used. She preached on repentance on Sunday, and she said when you repent, You learn to fully know God and fully know His love. Amen. That it's, you test His love and you taste it, even though when you don't deserve it.
Yeah.
And then He pulls you
completely
into His arm. Amen. And He cleanses you with His love. Right. And then that love changes you and draws you unto Him.
That's right.
And you don't have to hide it. When you blow it, when He's there the most to forgive you, He's a compassionate Amen. God. Amen. Because when you repent, the Lord is easily touched and moved by that repentance and His loving kindness and His mercy Amen. And His compassion Amen. Is released. That's why He sent His only begotten Son. Amen. All you have to do is appropriate the salvation. Amen. That's why Jesus is a Savior. Amen.
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 Amen. It's amazing. Amen.
Well, Pastor Martin, you're yes. seeing these souls being tormented
yes.
by the worm that never dies and these mice and other things eating them up.
Yes.
So, and you're in your little safe circle,
right?
Right.
Yes.
So you didn't get touched, right? I mean, you.
In that circle, I didn't get touched at that time.
So what happened
later?
What happened later?
Yes. You see, after a while, the angels told me to lift myself up.
Mm-hmm.
He said, "Lift yourself up." See, in the spiritual world, you will things. Mm. So I will myself up. And we started hovering over hell ground.
Ooh.
And from that vantage, we could see a lot more of what was happening below. As we were hovering there, I thought that was a way for me to stay clear of all the demonic attack.
Yeah.
So I tried to even go away from him for a while to see if I could see the other side of the second part of the first heaven, I mean the first hell. But I couldn't, because even though there's no visible wall, you cannot see beyond what you're supposed to see.
Mm-hmm.
So as we were up there, suddenly I looked into this area, my forehead here,
mm-hmm.
and there was this tiny little animal, creature, I would call it that way, but it was the size of a louse. You know the louse that we have in the head? And it was there. And it was starting increasing, growing in size, and digging its way into my forearm.
Uh-oh.
And it was burning,
painful.
The only thing I compared to, and I say that this is a figurative way, but I say even a million African bees that stink you
wow.
at the same time
wow.
feel less painful than these things.
Ooh.
Because the pain was not local. It was all invading from head to toe. The whole body was like in this flame, which was not the burning of a fire, but it was like the
Excruciating pain
excruciating
that's reverberating
pain.
Through your whole body.
Through the whole body.
Wow.
The whole body.
Wow.
And I tried to take it out. I couldn't. I didn't have the
strength.
The strength to pull it out.
Wow.
And I looked at the angel that was with me, because at that time I could see him on my floating next to me for help. He just looked at me with a very stern face, like, "You're on your own there." But then after a while, when that, I would call it, that creature had done its thing on my forearm, I pulled it out. This time it came out.
Mm.
But then I don't know if it came out because I pulled it out or it came out because it has finished its work
yeah.
in me. So I asked the angel, "Why didn't you help him? Why didn't you help?" And he said that to me, "How would you tell the living about the pains of hell if you haven't experienced
Ooh.
Even a tiny bit of it?" That's why you had to experience that in order for you, when you testify, you have a feeling of what it's like. And for your own self, so you don't find yourself back here.
Wow.
And from there, we went down. And I came back to my place. And when I came back down, I landed next to a soul.
Hmm.
You know, spiritual thing, they change decor. Next to a soul who was a very angry, ferocious soul. When I landed there, he didn't want me next to him. So he looked at me, and he was ready for a fight to protect his territory. And I couldn't understand why somebody in hell wants a territory when he knows he has none. So I just got ready for fight. So he came at me. I started rebuking him in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I rebuke you, I bind you. Nothing worked. Nothing. So he came. He was about to push me out of that safe space. And suddenly from my mouth came the word peace.
Shalom,
peace. I screamed, peace. And when I screamed, he stopped, froze, got very scared, and
took off. Wow.
And the other group of souls that were there, I don't know how the decor just changed. From painful soul, I was now dealing with other souls that were able to attack me, which was a lesson for me to learn about rebuking.
Yeah.
Other souls heard the word peace, which is a forbidden word in heaven and in hell. Brothers and sisters, you need to use the word shalom.
Amen.
Because that word is Amen. Only used in heaven.
Amen.
That's
in
right.
hell, you don't hear it.
Yeah.
So when I say the word peace, they didn't like it because it has such a vibratory power, such a higher spiritual power that it is forbidden in hell. How can you say peace in hell when everybody is suffering?
Wow.
So they came also to attack me because they didn't want to hear that word. And this time there were many of them. But suddenly, as I knew the word peace, I didn't say it anymore, but my angel interfered by just beaming on them his presence.
Oh yeah.
His enlightened presence. And when they saw my guiding angel, they left.
Wow.
And the guardian angel taught me, he said, that word peace was used by the Lord Jesus Christ because that is a very powerful word that every Christian should be able to use the word peace. Shalom.
Amen.
Yeah.
Because that is the word that has its roots from heaven. And he said, that's why Jesus, every time he met with his disciple or people, he said, peace be with you.
Amen.
Even when he was with the demon, possessed person, he said, peace. Because he knows the power of this word. Now, when that happened, they left. My angels began to teach me quite a lot about why the rebuking in the name of Jesus Christ could not work in hell. He said, on earth, when you rebuke, when you cast out a demon, you are sending him where? To hell. You're sending him to his kingdom.
Right.
Now you are in his kingdom. Uh-huh. You are casting him to go where?
Right.
You are the guest here. He is in his kingdom. So the word Jesus Christ, rebuke in the name of Jesus Christ, doesn't work here.
That's working.
It only works on earth.
Wow.
And that makes a lot of sense. That's why some people in hell continue to call on the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
But it's just too late. It's a name
right.
that has no value anymore, no power.
Right.
When that was done, and I got the visit of the first humanoid demon. Now, that was the first time I saw a demon that looks human.
Wow.
He was naked, muscular, white, with no hair, with protruded eyebrow, very protruded, with teeth in seesaw, with very protruded ears also. And he had very shiny eyes. He wasn't tall. He was not a tall person. And he was looking at me, and we started communicating telepathically.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was wondering, what is he doing here where there's no demons of his kind? By the way, my guiding angel told me that those animal creatures were not animals. They were demonic spirits assigned to that part of hell
to
torture people in that form.
Wow. Right.
So they were not animals.
Wow, that is amazing.
Yes.
You know, we only have like 5 minutes left,
oh,
but before we finish,
yes,
I want to encourage you to buy the book, Beyond the Gate of Hell, so that you can finish reading the revelation that the Lord gave to the brother. Because if the Lord gave it, it's for a purpose. Amen?
Amen.
And we don't want you to go there. We want you to go to heaven. Amen?
Amen.
So Dexter and Brother Martin,
yes,
why don't you tell them, Dexter, why don't you close the prayer by praying, and Brother Martin, why don't you tell the people what you feel led of the Lord at this time, why they shouldn't go to hell. And then Dexter, you guys can pray and be led by God how you want to finish.
Amen.
We have 5 minutes. Amen.
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 Amen. Brothers and sisters.
Yes.
I am your brother in Christ.
Yes.
We're all brothers in Christ.
Amen. Yes.
They say, the Bible says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
Yes.
So that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting love.
Amen.
Life in heaven. God loves you.
Yes.
And he wants you in heaven.
Amen.
All you need to do is to recognize that you have sinned like all of us and fallen short of the glory of God.
Yes, Amen. Lord.
But if you confess your sin and repent of your sin,
Amen.
The Bible says he is just and faithful to forgive you.
That's right.
Yes.
And not only to forgive you, he will transform you.
That's right.
But if you follow the theologies of men and you abandon the word of God, what you will find yourself is you'll be taught falsehood and you will end up in a place that you don't want to end up.
Yes.
We are invited you today, whether you are a Christian or not, baptized or not, whether you go to church or not, there's one thing that the Lord wants of you, is for you to recognize your sinful nature, your sinfulness, and repent.
Amen.
He's willing to forgive you. Because the Bible said he will forgive every one of your sin except the sin against the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, which is denying God.
Yes.
You haven't denied God.
Amen.
You want to go to heaven.
Yes.
This is a true story.
Yes.
This is, hell is a place.
Yes.
It's a world. It exists as well as you exist where you are, as well as heaven exists. Make your choice when you still have time. Because once you close your eyes for eternity, there's no more excuse, no more choice. No matter how many prayers are said for you, you will not go to heaven because somebody prayed for you. You will go to heaven because you repented.
Amen.
Yes.
May God
Amen.
Hear your desire for repentance.
Amen.
And give you the opportunity to change.
Amen.
In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, Pastor, would you lead them in a prayer of salvation?
Amen.
Amen.
Yes.
It is easy to go to the Lord. And if you have made that decision to go to the Lord, just pray with me.
Amen.
Say, Lord Jesus Christ.
Lord Jesus Christ.
I am a sinner.
I am a sinner.
I have fallen short of your glory.
I have fallen short of your glory.
I need you.
I need you.
I invite you into my heart.
I invite you into my
heart. As my Lord and Savior.
As my Lord and Savior.
I want you to forgive me.
I want you to forgive
and
me.
And cleanse me with your blood.
And cleanse me with your
and
blood.
And reign in my life.
And reign in my life.
I invite you to be the king of my mind.
I invite you to be the king of my
the
mind.
The king of my soul.
The king of my
the
soul.
The king of my body.
The king of my body.
The king of my spirit.
The king of my
the
spirit.
The king of everything that I have.
The king of everything that I have.
I accept you.
I accept you.
And I reject the work of Satan.
And I reject the work of Satan.
I reject his teaching.
I reject his teaching.
I reject his influence.
I reject his influence.
And I confide myself and I surrender all to you.
I confide myself and I surrender all to you.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
If you've said this prayer, brother, you should rejoice.
Amen.
And now you're born again.
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Praise the Lord.
And call OCN and tell if you've accepted Jesus. Call or write to us at our website, shalomshalom.org. And I want to encourage you to buy the book, yeah. Beyond the Gate of Hell. You can get it at Amazon.com. It will bless your life.
Amen.
And remember, Jesus is the answer.
Amen.
Jesus. Amen. Accept Him and repent and receive the gift of His salvation. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. This has been your program, Jeremiah 29:11, with your servants.
Amen.
God bless you, and we'll see you next week. Shalom, shalom. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Wow, that was powerful.